Ascent Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Monetizing Innovation: How Smart Companies Design the Product Around the Price, by Madhavan Ramanujam and Georg Tacke. Narrated by Darren Stevens. Publisher's note: this audiobook has bonus material. Please contact whomever you purchased this audiobook from to request the material.
For Hema and Ulrika. Foreword. Innovation is my family business. My grandfather was a master electrician, master machinist, and inventor who came up with a new kind of fire alarm. My father is a physicist who worked day and night at the massive Bell Laboratories Research and Development Facility in Murray Hill, New Jersey, which now has his picture at the door. Growing up as a Bell Labs kid, I often wondered why these scientists, the smartest guys in the room for sure, were working in what looked and smelled an awful lot like a dungeon. Why weren't they rich and powerful? Of course, it may be that money and success weren't their goals, or there may be truth in the saying, good at chess is bad at life. But let me put it another way. Why don't all innovations become successful products? Why do so many fail? This book has the answer. Consider the way most companies turn ideas into products and services. They start by analyzing costs, a whole constellation of them: headcount, material inputs, machinery, tech requirements, infrastructure support, and on and on. They subtract these expenses from estimated revenues, and out pops the expected profit. On that basis, the company places its bets. But hold on. Where did the revenue number come from? There was no careful scrutiny of detailed inputs. Generally, there is nothing more than an educated guess. That's a wild asymmetry of precision. It's even more reckless when you consider that the two elements, revenue and expense, are equally important in determining viability. But it's much worse than that. With few exceptions, companies do not examine which features are important to the customer and which are only important to the inventor. They do not know whether the customer wants one flavor or a choice of many. They do not know if the customer will pay, wants to pay once, or will subscribe. This is unfair to the innovator. The innovation team should know whether they are wasting their long nights on a concept that will go nowhere. They should know, as is often the case, when a change to the vision could dramatically increase its appeal. But that requires knowledge companies just don't have. For the CEO, the executive team, and the R&D chief, this book lays out a battle-tested plan for getting back in control. It is based on the work that Simon Kucher and partners has done for hundreds of businesses, including my own. It's a straightforward plan, but not a simple one. Much of it counters the prevailing wisdom. There is no move fast and break things, but there is a lot of look before you leap. It may be my bias, but I read it as a love letter to inventors. Tough love in spots, but love nonetheless. Those scientists back at Bell Labs with Far Side cartoons taped to every door, the hard-working garage visionaries, the men and women of R&D teams everywhere, they all want the same thing. They want their ideas to come to life. They don't want them to die ignominious deaths on some back shelf. And for my fellow corporate executives, this is a manifesto. I know of no other book that makes such a clear case for ensuring great new ideas will succeed, or that so clearly explains why we're wasting billions of dollars right now. Ironically, given the title, Monetizing Innovation isn't all about the money. Instead, as the authors would say, it's about going from hoping to knowing. It's about taking control of your company's future. Eddie Hartman, co-founder and chief product officer of LegalZoom, January 2016. Part 1. The Monetizing Innovation Problem. Chapter 1. How Innovators Leave Billions on the Table. A Tale of Two Cars. Let's begin with a story about two new cars launched by two well-known, established car companies. One launch went very, very well. The other went very, very wrong. The first car in our story was launched by Porsche, a relatively small player in the multi-trillion-dollar global automotive industry, renowned for its 911 sports car that will take you down the road at nearly 200 miles per hour. In the early 1990s, Porsche was speeding off a financial cliff, if not at 200 miles per hour, then pretty rapidly. Annual sales were a third of what they had been in the 1980s. The company's manufacturing processes were inefficient and defective. The new CEO, Wendelin Wiedeking, at 41 years old, the youngest of a new generation of German auto manufacturing executives, decided to institute Japanese-style manufacturing techniques and quality improvements. Costs fell and sales rose, and the company was able to avoid disaster. The new CEO had bought Porsche some time. He knew the company needed a fundamental change, something different, something new. It needed, as most companies eventually do, to innovate or risk losing everything. It needed a new car. In the second half of the 1990s, the company began planning an automobile that was far outside the sports car niche it had focused on successfully for 50 years. Porsche decided to make a sport utility vehicle, an SUV, a family car associated not with racing's checkered flags, but with soccer moms and soccer dads slumped behind the wheel, mournfully recalling their lost youth. Porsche called its new car the Cayenne. A Porsche SUV? It didn't make sense. The Porsche brand was about speed and power, daring and engineering, not about loading up the family car with groceries and taking Emily, Mike, and their little friends to their Saturday games. What did Porsche know about SUVs? It had never built one before. But Porsche had done its homework. Specifically, it had designed and built the product, the Cayenne, around the price. When most people hear the word price, they think of a number. That's a price point. When we use the term price, we are trying to get at something more fundamental. We want to understand the perceived value that the innovation holds for the customer. How much is the customer willing to pay for that value? What would the demand be? Seen in this light, price is both an indication of what customers value and a measure of how much they are willing to pay for that value. Porsche understood all this when it set about creating the Cayenne. Porsche's top executives knew they had a bold, perhaps even revolutionary concept. They also knew the car would be a tremendous risk. They instructed their product team to rigorously determine what the customer wanted in a Porsche SUV and, importantly, how much they were willing to pay. The message was clear. If the customer was not willing to pay a price that would ensure success, Porsche would walk away from the Cayenne. Long before the first concept car rolled out of the engineering group center in Weissach, the product team conducted an extensive set of surveys with potential customers, gauging the appetite for a Porsche SUV and evaluating prices to find an acceptable range. They were pleased to find that customers were enthusiastic. Analysis showed that customers were willing to pay more for a Porsche SUV than they would for comparable vehicles from other manufacturers. The potential for a hit was there. This meant that Porsche could invest in building its SUV. But what exactly should it build? Porsche wasn't about to risk creating a car with a bloated design. Every single feature stood trial before the customer. Target customers wanted and were willing to pay for a high, and in this vehicle category unknown, level of sportiness. They expressed an interest in a powerful engine and a handling performance close to a sports car, despite the size of an SUV. Porsche's famous manual 6-speed racing transmission was not on the wish list. Out it went. But the voice of the customer convinced the Porsche engineers to include large cup holders, something Porsche was not used to. At every turn, the product team removed features the customers did not value, even if the engineers loved them, and replaced those with features customers were actually willing to pay for. Porsche's masterstroke was thinking about monetization long before product development for the SUV was in full speed, then designing a car with the value and features customers wanted the most around a price that made sense. The result was total corporate alignment. Porsche knew it had a winner and had the confidence to invest accordingly. Over time, the Cayenne enabled Porsche to generate the highest profits per car in the industry, the whole automotive industry. 10 years after it hit the market in 2003, Porsche was selling about 100,000 Cayennes annually, almost five times as many as it did in the launch year. Today, the Cayenne accounts for about half the company's total profit, with a venerable 911 generating a third. What's more, the Cayenne enabled Porsche to pay down a suffocating level of debt and increase its cash reserves. By any and all measures, the Cayenne was a roaring success. Why did Porsche succeed? It wasn't the company's engineering prowess, although the Cayenne drives quite nicely. And it wasn't a technological breakthrough that enabled Porsche to manufacture SUVs more efficiently or make consumer hearts beat faster. Porsche succeeded by designing the product around the price. This is what smart companies do. Now we turn to the second car in our tale. This car comes from Fiat Chrysler, a company that has six times the revenue of Porsche. In 2009, the massive automaker began working to bring something new into the world, a reimagining of the classic 1970s Dodge Dart. The new Dodge Dart was a crucial entry in a crucial market segment for Fiat Chrysler, compact cars. Fiat Chrysler needed the Dart badly to make the company competitive in the category, a segment in which it had struggled for years. Compacts account for one in every six vehicles sold in America. Every major automaker must succeed in the compact market, explained Fiat Chrysler CEO Sergio Marchionne in a March 2012 interview on 60 Minutes. Any car maker unable to succeed in the category was doomed, he said. Marchionne didn't mince words within the company about the importance of the Dart. He told employees just what was riding on the car. Our future hangs on how well we do here, he told workers in a 2012 visit to the car's Belvidere, Illinois plant. He backed up his words with money, committing hundreds of millions of dollars to turn a very successful Fiat model, the Alfa Romeo Giulietta, into a Dodge Dart. Of all the cars I can get wrong, Marchionne said, it ain't this one. Both cars were equally critical to their company's futures. However, Fiat Chrysler's approach to developing the Dart was radically different from Porsche's Cayenne. Rather than starting with a hard look at the customer, Fiat Chrysler took a hard look at the product. As it documented in a 90-second TV commercial to market the car, Fiat Chrysler's product development process was to design it, build it, rethink it, design it, build it, rethink it, until the engineering team, in its exclusive opinion, felt the car was ready to go. In fact, the advertisement announced proudly that the company was kicking the finance guys out of the development process. Money was not going to be an issue. The company would build prototype after prototype to get it right. The executive team's suits would only interfere with designing the Dart. This car would be built to perfection, the commercial suggested. Perfection as defined by Fiat Chrysler, not the customer. Then a price was slapped on, and Dodge took it to customers to try to sell it. Market performance was a disaster. In 2012, the year it launched, the Dart sold about 25,000 units, a quarter of the total predicted by market analysts, and a number that caused Dow Jones Market Watch to call the Dart the year's second biggest new product flop. The number one spot was given to Apple's buggy iPhone mapping software. That's right, the Dart was Apple Maps bad. Since then, the Dart has failed to lure most compact car buyers away from the two-segment leaders, Toyota's Corolla and Honda's Civic, or even from Chevrolet's Cruze and Ford's Focus. By the end of 2014, sales were so disappointing that the company had to issue temporary layoffs at its Belvidere plant. Ironically, these were the same workers who 2 years earlier had heard Marchionne say that the Dart was the one car the company couldn't afford to get wrong. In the first 9 months of 2015, Dart sales were only a seventh of the combined sales of the two compact segment leaders. Fiat Chrysler couldn't afford to get the Dart wrong, but it did. The reason Porsche succeeded with the Cayenne and the reason Fiat Chrysler bombed with the Dart are the same reasons product innovations have succeeded or failed at so many companies and so many industries over the last 30 years. Porsche placed customer needs, value, willingness to pay, and pricing in the driver's seat when it developed the Cayenne. Fiat Chrysler stuffed them in the trunk. This story is less about the cars than about the two different modes of thinking that went into launching them, and why one way produced a success that helped put its company on an accelerated growth path, while the other produced a flop that led to layoffs. Porsche designed its new car around the price, what the customer valued and wanted to buy. Fiat Chrysler did not. This story illustrates the main theme of this book, how companies bringing something new into the world can leverage the science of monetizing innovation, increase the chances that their new offerings will succeed, and produce results that can be magical. The odds against successful innovation are always high, but as you read, you'll learn how a focus on monetizing innovation can substantially increase your chances of financial success. Unhappily, more new products in every industry go the way of the dart, and far too few enjoy the success of the Cayenne. We see it all the time. But every company has a chance to create Cayennes and reduce the risk of darts. The key is to rigorously determine the market for a new product long before the products are built, and making sure the market is willing to pay for that product before embarking on a long journey of productizing the innovation. Why the majority of new products fail. Each year, more and more of us find ourselves in Porsche's position. Success is defined by bringing new products to market, expanding our reach. The pace of change is accelerating worldwide. For many of us, innovation is no longer a question of prioritization or investment, it's a question of survival. Yet the failure rate for innovation is shockingly high. Nearly 3 out of 4 new products or services miss their revenue and profit goals. Many of those crash and burn entirely, and some take their companies with them. It doesn't have to be that way. That's what this book is about. For 30 years, we have helped companies develop strategies for successful innovation, including the launch of the Porsche Cayenne that we described. During that time, we have uncovered the patterns of failure that doom so many innovations. More important, we have forged and empirically validated a framework that has helped innovative companies ranging from startups to global brands to meet or exceed their goals. New products fail for many reasons, but the root of all innovation evil, what billionaire entrepreneur Elon Musk would call the set of first principles, is the failure to put the customer's willingness to pay for a new product at the very core of product design. Most companies postpone marketing and pricing decisions to the very end, when they've already developed their new products. They embark on the long and costly journey of product development, hoping they'll make money on their innovations, but not at all knowing if they will. Price is more than just a dollar figure. It is an indication of what the customer wants and how much they want it. It is the single most critical factor in determining whether a product makes money. Yet, it is an afterthought, a last-minute consideration made after a product is developed. It is so much of an afterthought that companies frequently call us and say, "We built a product. Oops, now we need your help in pricing it." To boil it down, these companies conduct product development this way. They design, then build, then market, then price. What we will teach you in this book is to flip that process on its head. Market and price, then design, then build. In other words, design the product around the price. Think back to the last business case you or your colleagues were asked to write for a new product. How did you arrive at your prices? Did you compare your product to other products in the marketplace, or did you actually ask customers what they'd pay for it? Did you know in advance what would happen if you increased your price by, say, 20%? That is, how that would likely affect demand and thus volume? If you are like thousands of companies that we've worked with over the years, you probably did not. Every one of them claims to have made an airtight business case to top management that vouches for their new product. But in only about 5% of those business cases can you find information on how much customers will pay for the product. This means their revenue estimates are at best a guess. When you think about it, that's stunning. The business case gives them a level of confidence they should not have. It leads them down the path to failure. The most successful product innovators we know start by determining what the customer values and what they are willing to pay, and then they design the products around these inputs and have a clear monetization strategy that they follow through with. That's what LinkedIn did before it launched its talent solution service for job recruiters, which now drives the lion's share of the social networking site's revenue and profits. That's what Porsche did with the Cayenne, and what Fiat Chrysler failed to do with the Dart. That's what a large global pharmaceutical company has done with new products since the turn of the millennium, which has helped the company grow enormously over the last 20 years. That's what crystal maker Swarovski has done in developing new offerings for consumers and for companies that embed its crystals in their products to great financial success. That's what Draeger, a manufacturer of gas detection equipment, did in creating a hit new product that protects miners and other underground workers from gas leaks, a product whose sales were 250% higher than expected. That's what a 6-year-old software-as-a-service firm called Optimizely did in creating a software to help companies improve their website's abilities to sell their offerings, a software that has been used by thousands of customers. And that's what Uber has done in shaking up the world of public transportation while watching its private valuation soar towards $60 billion at the end of 2015. We'll tell you much more about how LinkedIn, Porsche, Swarovski, Draeger, Optimizely, Uber, and an innovative pharma profited from designing and developing products around the price in Chapter 13. This is the model that forward-looking, highly successful product innovators use, companies whose principles for monetizing innovations we will deconstruct in this book. Successful innovation matters more than ever. Succeeding at product innovation is difficult, and it always has been. Every other year, Simon Kucher and Partners conducts the world's largest survey on the state of pricing. Our 2014 report polled executives in 1,615 companies across the United States, Japan, Germany, and 37 other countries. The primary focus of the survey was to measure how well companies were monetizing their innovations across industries and geographies. The disappointing findings were reported in Harvard Business Review. 72% of new products introduced over the last 5 years failed, either to meet their revenue and profit goals or failed entirely. These figures applied equally to startups and large businesses in every industry surveyed. Numerous other studies over the last decade have said your chances of developing a successful innovation are not even as good as winning a coin flip. For example, 65% of new products fail, according to the Product Development and Management Association. That rate of failure cost U.S. companies $260 billion in 2010, according to researchers at the University of Texas at Austin. 75% of venture capital-funded startups fail, according to a Harvard Business School study of 2,000 companies between 2004 and 2010. These numbers show something is very wrong with the way companies bring new concepts to market. No one is immune. As painful as it is to consider, the odds are stacked against all of us. Yet succeeding at innovating has never been more important than it is now. In the 2014 Simon Kucher & Partners study, 83% of companies reported facing increasing downward pricing pressures. Most companies plan to innovate their way out of this dilemma. New products, new services, and new paths to growth. But innovators face an uphill climb for four primary reasons. 1. Traditional research and development, R&D, is becoming more expensive, not less. Costs are going up rapidly without being offset by price increases. 2. Disruptive innovation now comes from smaller and smaller companies with lighter and lighter capital requirements, meaning they can be nimbler than your firm and take bigger risks. 3. Product innovation is no longer the preserve of the Western world, as evidenced by the United States and Europe's declining shares of global R&D spending and the growing share of China and other Asian countries. In fact, China is predicted to eclipse the United States in R&D spending by 2020. 4. The rate of innovation is accelerating. A key signpost? Annual global patent applications leaped 2.5 times from 1995 to 2013, and in 2014 set a record for the number of patents filed internationally. Those statistics are harrowing, but with a 72% global new product failure rate, you can take comfort knowing that if you are facing problems successfully launching innovations, you are not alone. The good news: monetizing innovation failures come in only 4 varieties. This book is a product of the lessons that Simon Kucher and partners has learned over the last 30 years while becoming the world's largest pricing and monetization consulting firm, one with more than 900 employees in 32 offices around the world. Globally, we've conducted more than 10,000 projects for large multinationals, mid-sized companies, as well as startups across industries. We've seen what works and what doesn't, what succeeds and what fails in product innovation. We've found recurring patterns in new product monetization failure. While you might think many types of flaws can cause products to flop in the marketplace, we actually have found that monetizing failures fall into only 4 categories. 1. Feature shock. Cramming too many features into one product, sometimes even unwanted features, creates a product that does not fully resonate with customers and is often overpriced. 2. Minivation. An innovation that, despite being the right product for the right market, is priced too low to achieve its full revenue potential. 3. Hidden gem. A potential blockbuster product that is never properly brought to market, generally because it falls outside of the core business. 4. Undead. An innovation that customers don't want but has nevertheless been brought to market, either because it was the wrong answer to the right question or an answer to a question no one was asking. The fact that new product monetization failures come in only 4 varieties should give you comfort. Imagine having to do postmortems that could point to dozens or hundreds of factors. You can avoid failure, but only if you play by different rules. Our experience allowed us not only to diagnose these monetization failure modes, but to cure them, or even better, avoid them altogether. In this book, we have boiled these secrets down into the following 9 new rules for innovation success. The rules are contrary to what most executives have learned about product development. 1. Have the willingness to pay talk with customers early in the product development process. If you don't do it early, you won't be able to prioritize the product features you develop, and you won't know whether you're building something customers will pay for until it's in the marketplace. 2. Don't force a one-size-fits-all solution. Whether you like it or not, your customers are different, so customer segmentation is crucial. But segmentation based on demographics, the primary way companies group their customers, is misleading. You should build segments based on differences in your customers' willingness to pay for your new product. 3. Product configuration and bundling is more science than art. You need to build them carefully and match them with your most meaningful segments. 4. Choose the right pricing and revenue models because how you charge is often more important than how much you charge. 5. Develop your pricing strategy. Create a plan that looks a few steps ahead, allowing you to maximize gains in the short and long term. 6. Draft your business case using customer willingness to pay data and establish links between price, value, volume, and cost. Without this, your business case will tell you only what you want to hear, which may be far afield from market realities. 7. Communicate the value of your offering clearly and compellingly. Otherwise, you will not get customers to pay full measure. 8. Understand your customers' irrational sides, because whether you sell to other businesses or to consumers, your customers are people. You should take into account their full psyches, including their emotions, in making purchase decisions. 9. Maintain your pricing integrity. Control discounting tightly. If demand for your new product is below expectations, only use price cuts as a last resort after all other measures have been exhausted. We don't want to suggest this is easy. Real change never is. Some chapters will teach you tactics that will ratchet up your odds of success all by themselves. But the power of our 9-rule approach lies in how each rule reinforces the one before it. It is an integrated framework, meaning that the true potential of our approach, the real game changer, can only be realized if you commit, body and soul. To further enable the change, we have created a website, www.monetizinginnovation.com, that provides additional material and diagnostic tools. No matter who you are, where you are, what you make, or what service you provide, the stakes for new products and services are much higher than ever before. In the pages that follow, we'll give you the insights you need to dramatically improve the odds of new product success, techniques that will help your new product avoid becoming one of the four monetizing innovation failure types, and instead fit into a fifth category, the big success. Chapter 2, Feature Shocks, Minivations, Hidden Gems, and Undeads, the four flavors of monetizing innovation failure. As we mentioned at the end of the previous chapter, we have analyzed thousands of new product and service monetizing innovation failures for clients over the last 30 years, and we find they fall into four categories: feature shocks, minivations, hidden gems, and undeads. The good news is that there are only four categories. That makes it easier to avoid them. Which of these missteps you will likely make has a lot to do with your company's culture. Companies with strong, product-driven or engineering cultures tend to be the ones that develop feature shocks. Firms with a culture of playing it safe and avoiding big risks typically suffer minivations. Hidden gems most often afflict companies that coddle the core business. And undeads are born in firms whose top-down cultures discourage feedback and criticism from below. Let's start with feature shocks, something anyone who comes from a company with a strong engineering culture will immediately recognize. Flavor 1. Feature shocks, when you give too much and get too little. Feature shocks happen when you try to cram too many features into one product, creating a confusing and often expensive mess. In a sincere effort to have it be all things to all people, you launch a product that pleases few. The result is the product's value is less than the sum of the parts. Due to its multitude of features, none of them a standout, these products are costly to make, over-engineered, hard to explain, and usually overpriced. Feature shocks typically begin when a company has uncertain or ambitious goals. At Amazon, ambitious goals are part of the core culture. The company thinks big, from its product warehouses to its vast cloud computing data centers. Through thinking big, Amazon has reaped big rewards. In February 2016, Amazon's market capitalization was $250 billion, making it worth 18% more than Walmart, the world's biggest retailer by revenue. But that did not help Amazon in 2014, when it attempted to launch its own entry into the smartphone market. With the Fire Phone, Amazon bet it could compete against the reigning champions of consumer smartphones, Samsung and Apple. In the tech world, goals don't get much more ambitious. But Amazon had scored big before in consumer electronics with its innovative Kindle ebook readers and Kindle Fire tablets. Amazon has logged years of successes across product categories using its well-known outside-in and customer-first focus. So Amazon skipped the low-margin marketplace of budget phones and set sail for the shores of the premium smartphone market with the Fire Phone, counting on innovative features to make a market splash akin to what Apple's automated assistant, Siri, had created. Amazon packed in a sizable 4.7-inch screen, a hefty 32 gigabytes of storage, a Bluetooth wireless capability to connect the Fire Phone with other devices, and many other bells and whistles. In a sea of features, the most startling was Dynamic Perspective, which was designed to give consumers three-dimensional effects on the smartphone display without having to wear 3D glasses. To pull this off, Amazon's designers installed four camera lenses and facial recognition technology that followed your line of sight to the phone, tweaking the display to show depth. Amazon also threw in what it called Mayday Service, which promised technology support in less than a minute. The company also touted Firefly, a shopping feature that let you point the phone's camera at a product and then took you to Amazon.com to buy it. Amazon tried hard to generate the kind of buzz that accompanies a new iPhone release, but reviewers saw little value in the numerous features, especially dynamic perspective, which looked impressive in some smartphone games but didn't address any pressing customer needs. Making matters worse, the four lenses required to support dynamic perspective were a big drain on the phone's battery life. Critics were particularly harsh on the muddled feature set. The review from technology site Engadget was typical. "The Fire's defining features are fun, but I can't help but feel as though they're merely gimmicks designed by Amazon to demonstrate the company's brilliance, and at the expense of battery life to boot. Dynamic perspective might be useful in a few cases, games mainly, but it won't provide the user with functionality they'd sorely miss if they went with an iPhone or flagship Android device." Not only is the Fire lacking in useful new features, but its high price guarantees its irrelevance. So why come out with a smartphone that isn't particularly convenient and isn't particularly cheap? By no means is the Fire a horrible phone, but it's a forgettable one. You might want the eventual Fire Phone 2, perhaps, but for now, you're better off sticking with what you know. Amazon launched the phone in July 2014 at $199 with a 2-year AT&T phone service contract, or $649 without a contract. Initial sales lacked momentum, and when sales stalled out 4 months later, Amazon cut the phone's price to 99 cents, that's not a misprint, with a 2-year contract, or $449 without a contract. Instead of basking in an Apple-like glow, Amazon was left with a $170 million write-down, largely attributable to unsold Fire Phone inventory, according to Fast Company. How does this type of mistake get made at an ultra-disciplined and very successful company like Amazon? It gets made because Amazon, like countless companies that produce engineering marvels, over-engineered the product. It fell in love with the phone's many features, including some that no one outside the company wanted. Amazon fell prey to the spirit of, "We can add this." The drive to make a product that addresses too many questions often blinds innovation teams to market realities. Then the ill-advised trade-offs in product development happen, like the battery life quandary. The Fire Phone became an over-engineered product bursting with non-essential features that hiked its cost for Amazon, and therefore the price for customers, and it lacked standout features. Amazon might still succeed with Fire Phone 2, but the first incarnation was a feature shock. When you look into organizations that are susceptible to feature shocks, the warning signs are usually subtle, but they follow patterns that you will recognize if you have ever worked in such a company. If you hear this, you are likely designing a feature shock. "But we can also add this." We want to be on the safe side. "Customers don't know what they want, so we need to decide what to build." "One size should fit. Our market is not segmented." "Let's build it, then position it." "Let's get something out there." The first danger signal is that the research and development, R&D team, keeps saying, "Let's add this," but can't articulate the new product's value to customers. Years ago, we met with a team to develop a pricing strategy for a product meant to revolutionize testing and monitoring for a class of machinery. Intrigued, we asked why someone should buy the product. The team members looked at each other quizzically before all eyes focused on the team leader. "This product has 7 patents," the team leader finally said, missing the point that customers couldn't have cared less about that. We refer to such comments as inside out, meaning they reflect what people inside a company believe is valuable about their firm's new product. Inside out comments like that indicate that an R&D team has fallen in love with the product but has lost sight of the customer. That may be the earliest and most reliable indication that the product you are about to launch is suffering from feature shock. Customers won't buy a product if they do not buy your story about why that product helps them. Products that are feature shocks cannot articulate a clear value proposition and tend to be a one-size-fits-all approach to customers. When feature shocks come to market, customers' initial responses are tepid. That only increases the innovator's frustration. Customers complain the product has too many nice-to-haves and too few gotta-haves, and they conclude they don't need the product, at least at that price. And if they do like some of the nice-to-haves, they can't afford them. There is no compelling value story for the customer, and too high a price for non-compelling value because the features have hiked its cost. Naturally, adoption is slower than the company expects. Indifferent, unenthusiastic word of mouth fails to generate follow-up sales. After Amazon launched its Fire phone, no one talked about its dynamic perspective feature the way they had talked about the iPhone's Siri. Once a company recognizes a feature shock problem, it often slashes the price. This is the simplest and fastest way to correct, or at least offset, an unclear value proposition. This is what Amazon did with its Fire phone. The allure of a lower price point is undeniable. It also is the easiest lever to pull when a new offering's sales are below expectations, whether they are consumer gadgets or sophisticated products and services sold to businesses. Salespeople can change a price in the middle of a sentence. They can offer the product as a throw-in for a deal. They can quote the new price and represent it as a discount or an adjustment in terms and conditions. This insidious process can escalate into a full-scale rescue attempt as the organization loses its ability to control the price or enforce any pricing restraint. In the worst cases, finance and pricing teams face customer demands for ever higher discounts, and the price goes into a downward death spiral, leaving the company unable to slow or stop the decline. In Chapter 12, we will discuss repair tactics other than price cutting to deal with initial sales disappointments. A quick price slash is the worst of all options. Clearly, lack of restraint in product development fuels feature shocks. Technology companies are most susceptible to encouraging the spirit of, let's add this. Semiconductor companies, for example, routinely produce feature shocks. It's not uncommon to have a design specification with hundreds of features. But organizations from many other industries fall into the same feature shock trap. Take the U.S. cable TV industry. For years, cable operators offering hundreds of channels struggled with a feature shock, getting customers to select which of the numerous premium channels they wanted the most. So most cable providers created a few package solutions, each of which offered groups of premium channels. That simplified the consumer's purchase decision. Every day, all of us run into products that are living feature shocks. The financial services industry has plenty of them. For example, retail banks whose accounts offer money transfer services, credit cards, brokerage services, foreign exchange, and more. Or go into an electronics store and have a salesperson explain to you the wonders of a top-end, high-definition TV. Then see if you can remember them all. Or go into an appliance store and let them regale you with the features of a new high-end clothes washer. If you are like the average consumer, maybe you'd end up using 20% of all those features. The reason such products become feature shocks is a lack of restraint by innovation teams. They couldn't help themselves, thinking up and packing in another seemingly attractive feature. Such lack of discipline produces a feature shock that then typically leads to rampant, profit-destroying discounting. You can avoid creating feature shocks. You will need to tailor products differently to the needs of different customer segments based on what each segment needs and what they'll pay for products that solve those needs. We'll say a lot more about this in Chapter 5. Flavor 2. Minivations. When you ask for too little, that's what you get. No one wants to sell his or her idea short. Minivations are products that tap neither a product concept's full market potential nor its full price potential. Companies that fall into the minivation trap underexploit the market opportunity and the price they could have charged, thereby robbing themselves of profits. Minivations go down as under-monetized products cursed with a what-might-have-been tag. With minivations, failure can masquerade as success. We worked with a Silicon Valley component maker that provides internal parts for handheld digital devices. This company, fighting hard at a time of keen competitive pressure, created a next-generation product that represented not an incremental improvement, but a step change. This new generation component had no peer. The company priced the component at 85 cents.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.